Are you looking to hire a photographer? Check out Windsor's own Melissa Fay Photography. With affordable and professional services ranging from lifestyle newborn to weddings and any of life's important events in between. Mention Hat Trick Hockey and enjoy 10% off any service. Find her on social media as Melissa Fay Photography.
And welcome everybody. It's episode 33 of Hat Trick Hockey. That is always sponsored by our good friends over at GL Heritage, the official beer of Hat Trick Hockey. Rob, this is the Patrick Waugh edition of the show here. A little bit on Waugh real quick before we get to you, Rob. 19 seasons, 1,029 games played, 2.54 goals against average, 910 save percentage, 66 shutouts, 551 wins. Five-time Jennings Trophy, lowest goals against, four-time Stanley Cup champ, three-time Vezina, three-time Conn Smythe. He's also won a Calder Cup, and he went into the Hall of Fame in 06-07. That's Patrick Waugh.
And a partridge in a pear tree.
So he's another one of those guys that has done everything. Rob, what is going on, man? Fucking Snowmageddon out there.
Holy balls, man. I couldn't even go to work today. Dude, I tried backing my car out of the driveway and it started lifting the back of the car up. So like I just pulled forward again, came back in the house, called my boss, said, hey, I can't come in.
Yeah, I can't even get out of the fucking driveway.
No, I couldn't get out of the driveway, let alone, you know, like, and then he's like, well, you know, you should try and get in. Well, I you know, with my heart issues and everything, I can't fucking shovel the driveway. But I have a great neighbor who end up, before the end of the day, end up snowblowing my driveway. And what a fucking total beaut, Mike Gorey. I really appreciate him. Thank you very much.
Total beaut.
And I got another neighbor across the street that I had texted. I asked him when he got home from work if he'd be able to do it. And he said, no problem. So I got a lot of love coming around here. In the neighborhood.
That's a good thing because that snow is fucking heavy. I shoveled a bunch of it today.
Yeah, well, then I had to get my boy because they can only get the snowblower up so far closest to the house, right? And then Glenn had to go up and I bet he spent a half an hour out there just shoveling the walkway out of the front, the side door there just to be able to get to the car.
Yeah, it was crazy, man. You got to stay.
Everything, Jeremy.
You have to say.
Oh, and I wanted to mention too, Valentine's Day was a big success at Misty's house. You know, we got some, what do you call them, oysters?
Oh, yeah.
And crab legs. It was the first time we did crab legs, and man, did it turn out great. What a great Valentine's Day.
Rob just crushing it?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we didn't do a whole lot for that. We just kind of hung out with the kids and stuff like that. I think we might have ordered some pizza.
Yeah,
we just hung out, man. It was all right. But now out there, man, it's so fucking cold, so you have to stay warm. So here's a good way to stay warm, Rob, is in our merch store. We have zip up hoodies for $40. We still have the cotton shirts and the snapback hats like you're wearing right there for $25. And we have the cotton hoodie and the border toque for $35. So you can't get much better than that. So if you guys want to stay warm, hit up Laser Art on our site anywhere. Click a link. Goes right to the store. Order your merch. It's good stuff.
They're total beauts there over there. They'll take care of you.
Yeah. So before we get going here real quick, I just want to just talk about one of my friends real quick, Francis Long. So Francis Long, our boy, he had some like heart issues. So he's been in the like hospital for a bit. And with all this COVID shit, can't really see anybody, but he's able to make like phone calls and speak with his like family and stuff like that. I've like shot the shit with Frank a few times. He's back to his witty like self, shall we say. But I just want to say to Frank, like, I wish you all the best, buddy, speedy recovery. And, we want to see you right back on the ball field with us as soon as possible.
Yeah. That's coming from all of us at Hat Trick Hockey, Francis. You know you got some great family there, Brandy and Jordy. Yeah. So we know you're being well taken care of.
Yeah. So I've been looking for his dad, Jeff there. He's been throwing up some like updates and stuff, so I've been kind of watching his posts and stuff. So best of luck, Frank. And we're definitely thinking about you, buddy. So get well soon. That being said, we'll go right into the hockey here. Patrick Laine already benched for lipping off to a coach already. So what do you think on that, Rob? Do you think these, like, but it wasn't to the head coach. He didn't have the balls to do it to Torts. He did it to a assistant coach. So what do you think on that, Rob?
Well, I think Torts put him in the doghouse just for that alone. Those are his guys. Mm-hmm. You know, that talking to them like that is just like talking to him like that. So, you know what I mean? Like, I don't understand the what's going through your head. You know what I mean? You haven't made it. Yeah. Do you have a hell of a fucking shot? Yeah, you do. Like, you're an amazing hockey player. Why can't you just be a hockey player? Why do you got to be such a dick?
Yeah, I know.
You know, like.
I agree, man.
This is going to get you another team. And then once people start, coaches and teams start figuring that shit out, where are you going to be? You know, you're playing in a K.
Yeah, that is true. Yeah, and that's the thing, too, is he's so good. Like, he's such a good player. Like, if he's one of those guys, he just needs to just play the game and not worry about anything else.
Yep.
Just play
the game. A lot of guys are like that. Like, there's still that, you know, there's lots of problems in the NHL. Oh, you know, crazy. Like, I don't know. It's not like it used to be where players were all afraid of their coaches. Now they're just like, we're the ones that make the money. Go fuck yourself.
I know. It's crazy, man. It's crazy how it gets like that. Also, Pittsburgh there, Ron Hextall is the new general manager. Then they really shake things up and they bring in Brian Burke as the new president of hockey operations. You think that's a huge kick in the ass to the whole fucking squad or what?
Well, you got to figure some shit out, right? And I guess apparently from what I heard, I was listening to, I don't know whether it was TSN or who had him on, but he was saying that he was basically doing that already for one of the guys like in Vancouver.
Mm-hmm.
So he wasn't even on the radar to get that job. And I don't know who the owner is of the Vancouver Canucks, but they said, well, who are you getting your information from? They're like, Brian Burke. Mm-hmm. They're like, well, why aren't we interviewing him? So they end up throwing that at him. And he's like, well, you know, I don't know. I'm really enjoying my, you know, stint at, where was he on Sportsnet?
Yeah.
And he said he was really enjoying it and learning to be a better, you know, interviewer, you know, broadcaster, however you want to look at it. And he said, you know, he went home and thought about it and then said, shit, why not? I'm already doing it. So, but there was supposed to be an incident. If I can just find this real quick, where Hextall was getting interviewed by Mario and Mario was giving him the gears about knocking his teeth out.
What?
If you can believe that. Yeah. At some point in the interview, I wish I could find, I'm trying to find it right now, but yeah.
When, like when they had a shot or a fight or something?
I don't know whether it was the stick. Like I said, I'm kind of searching for it.
We'll have to look that up. Like maybe there's a video.
I'm sure there would be, but like even though that he was interviewing him for the job or whatever, he ended up bringing it up and
kind of got to rise him a little bit.
Right, right.
It's no fun if you don't. Look at freaking Iserman there asking kids if they're smoking weed. Same thing.
Yeah, but they're not knocking his teeth out.
No, that is true. Hey, did you hear about the NHL? They're playing two games at Lake Tahoe. You seen that, eh? So I believe it's this weekend. So the 20th, Colorado is going to play Las Vegas at 3:00. And then the following day, you're going to see Boston and Philly, and they're going to play at 3:00. How cool is that?
It's very cool, but it's not actually on the lake.
I know it's not. It's a rink beside the lake.
Right.
But you get the whole view of the mountains and everything like that. That's pretty fucking sweet.
Yeah, that'd be like playing in fucking Europe somewhere, eh?
Kind of, yeah, actually. So moving on, actually, from that real quick before we go over to our interview, which was a fucking sick interview. So the NHL has enhanced its COVID protocol. Okay, so they made a few little changes. So one of them is like a work home quarantine. So to keep the numbers and everything down, effective immediately, all players, coaches, training staff, anybody on staff, anybody involved with the team, traveling party, anybody, they can't do anything except stay home and go to their games or their freaking practices. If they exercise, it has to, it can be outdoors by themselves. And the only other thing they can leave their house for is if it's something like medical. That's the only thing they can really leave their house for.
I don't understand why these guys can't work out together. They play together. They sit right on the bench next to each other. That doesn't make any sense to me.
I don't know, man. That's just how they're doing it. They're trying to keep the numbers down. So the reinforcement for the preventative measures. So the NHL is going to ensure everybody that they're trying to teach all the players like the importance of like wearing your mask at all times and like doing your exercise, maintaining your social distance and everything. So they're trying to really hammer that in. So it almost sounds like players are like they have to take like a little course or something, like a little crash course or something with the league almost on to how they want everything to be. It's kind of weird, eh?
Yeah.
The other thing is facial covering. So everyone, obviously, you know this, everybody has to wear a mask. So whether you're in the dressing room, whatever, if you're in the room, all players, anybody in the room has to be wearing a mask. They have the KN95 ones there or whatever. So that's the ones that they've been using. The guys who are in the games or practices or whatever, players, obviously, they can remove their masks as they're getting ready to go out onto the ice. But other than that,
do you know what the 95 stands for?
What's that?
95% efficient.
Oh, does it?
Yep.
Never knew that, bro, honestly.
Check out the big brain on Bob.
Big brain Bobby. Also, they're like bringing in like your household members. So they're trying to give everybody like, I don't know, by the way it sounds is the goal is to just keep everything down, obviously. So they're gonna, by the way it sounds, they're actually running fucking tests and stuff on anybody who lives in your house, so that way if somebody in your house has it, they can knock it down before it even gets into the rink. So by the way,
crazy.
Yeah, it's nuts, man. It's crazy.
So is that still the snot swab, like where they go up your nose?
Yeah.
So how often does that have to happen?
I would think the players probably have to do it a lot, man. In a week, I bet you you're going at least 3 to 4 times a week to have a test on.
And that means family members as well?
I don't know if it's the family members, but either way, it will just be like, I don't know, man. They're trying to just knock down all interaction, which is what I'm going into right here. So the teams have been asked to reduce the amount of time that they spent like as a group. So that means team meetings, like social like settings. I don't want them going to like dinners or anything together, or hanging out in the rooms together. They can't go out and have everything at the places where they stay. So like the bars, everything like that, they're all to be closed by midnight, no later. So they're just cutting everything out from these guys, man. Three, the players with the recent like positives, they're like, you're in a revised like seating arrangements, like in the rooms, on the planes, on the buses, everything. So if you have tested positive and you are back with the team for 90 days, you have assigned seating in the room during travel or team meals. So for example, a player who has a freaking positive test and is back and it was less than 90 days ago, doesn't have to be, but should be seated next to somebody who has never had the virus. That's what they're saying. Or someone who has recovered from the virus for more than 90 days. Isn't that weird?
That's nuts.
Like, why would they want to do that?
I don't know. I would think that you would sit next to somebody that's had it. Like, you know what I mean? Like two guys that have had it.
It's almost like they're trying to get like some sort of immunity or something. You know what I mean?
It's weird. Yeah, I don't know. Like, it's just fucked.
It's a fucking weird situation. Another point was what you actually brought up last episode, how they're like, don't have the glass now behind the benches and the penalty boxes. So that's gone. Now they have tracking systems too on the guys, so they can tell like when you've been affected and this and that. It's crazy, dude. And yeah, that's pretty much about it.
I don't know. It's kind of crazy. Just
your mind boggled right now.
Yeah, that's some crazy shit just to play a freaking kids game, you know?
Yeah, all this for these guys to play hockey. So that being said, should we pop it over to our interview here or what?
Absolutely.
So for you guys, since you guys obviously know, because you probably already downloaded the episode. So we have Jeff Kugel on with us, and he was such a good guy. He was very funny. He was very witty. He said a lot of funny, like one like liners. So he was a pretty funny guy, and he didn't hold anything back either. So, and yes, people, we asked them about the incident. Okay. Yes. We asked them, we talked about it a little bit. Okay. So enjoy. Rob, what do you think here? Flip her over to Mr. Jeff Kugel.
Sounds good.
All right, everybody, enjoy. Jeff Kugel.
Roll it.
Ladies and gentlemen, this next man on with us is a former Sioux Greyhound, former Windsor Spitfire. I want to give a big hat trick hockey welcome to Mr. Jeff Kugel. Jeff, what's going on, buddy? How's things?
How you doing? I appreciate you having me on, and look forward to it.
So how's everything going with all this COVID crap?
It's probably as good as it could be. I don't know how it is over there for you guys, but across the border, I'm sure it's pretty similar. I've been with Xfinity for a while, not to jump to what I'm doing now, but all pretty much everyone in the sales force, you know, 80, 90% of them are pretty much let go now. No face-to-face transaction. So it's you know, tough right now, but everything's will work itself out, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm. Well, we'll hop right into her here. So how old were you when you started like playing like hockey, and where at?
I started playing a little late, probably, as opposed to most kids who made it, you know, to the OHL or juniors or something like that. I think I want to say I was in fourth grade, third or fourth grade, just starting. Bauer turbos. I don't know how old you guys are, but I mean, complete plastic boots, you know, slip-ins. And actually a friend of our family's is married into with Greg Steffen, who was a goalie for the Red Wings. Actually grew up in Brantford, Ontario, physically real close to Gretz. Grew up played with Probert on that team with Sean Burr, all those guys.
Yeah.
So he used to have a goalie camp over at Oak Park, which at the time was where CompTIA was. Eric Lindros was skating out of there, a bunch of other big names at the time. But I used to go to goalie camp. He'd have me shoot on the goalies, working my way up. And then pretty much, I mean, honestly, it was a steady dose of house hockey for a bit.
Mm-hmm.
I was a bit and a little, you know, only child. So I was a little bit less aggressive than I should have been. And it took me a minute to get up, but it was probably 4 or 5 years of straight, you know, throw a stick in pretty much. Coach will pick you out and, mm-hmm. you know, house hockey. It wasn't until I got a little older until I started traveling and getting on some good teams.
That was going to be my next thing I asked you, was how old were you when you started to play like travel hockey and stuff?
I started playing like in the States here. I don't know how it is there, but it's house, that which is, then there's like a double A, triple A is obviously the premier, CompTIA, Little Caesars, Toronto mm-hmm. Marlies, Red Wings, stuff like that. But honestly, I played 2 years of triple A and probably 3 years of double A before that. So probably till I was like in seventh grade, you know, we used to travel in A2, you go to 4 or 5 tournaments, but when you're in a triple A team and you start, you know, going to tournaments and hearing stories about some of the legends that obviously grew, you know, end up in the OHL with me. It's a big, way big, you know, it's a bigger difference playing, you know, whatever team it was from, you know, Markham, Ajax Pickering, you know, John Erskine's on the team, as opposed to, you know, in America as a kid, when we'd fight, it'd pretty much be just grabbing the face mask and wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
I hear stories about guys, you know, boys in Canada asking to go buckets off in like third, fourth grade. I mean, it's a wake up call, you know, it's definitely a wake up call.
Buckets off. Rob, go ahead, man. I feel like I'm hogging the questions here.
You are, because you're a puck hog. But anyways, what made you fall in love with the game, Jeff?
Honestly, it was my family. We used to go to these Easter Seal charity events, and I got a picture. I was going to try to get out. I'll send it to you guys, but it's me and Proby, and, you know, I just – Red Wings growing up in Detroit, you know, at the time, it was just – people were maniacal over the Wings, pretty close to the cup every time, and even since then, obviously, dynasties, back-to-backs a few times, but it's – it, you know, just being around it with my family, seeing those guys, going to the Joe so much, watching practices, eventually, you know. And at that young in America, it was crazy because a lot of people were like, why aren't you on the football field? Mm-hmm. What happened? You have a bad experience with it or something? I mean, actually, my last year before I got traded to the Sioux, I went to New York Rangers camp. Remember, I walked in there and we're in line. Everyone's going through warm-ups and you go through your way in. And as soon as I got weighed in, the trainers for the Rangers look in. This had been a year after I sat out for the suspension. So trainers look at each other and they're like, buddy, I think you missed it. You're down the arena. You're down the street. Giants camp's down the street. Like, I was just just expecting me to be so big and be an American. Like, why aren't you playing football or basketball? What are you doing? But this, you know, like I said, family was into it. And ever since once you start traveling and getting the hockey family, it's kind of a wrap after that.
So, like, how old were you when you started getting, like, the sniffs from, like, the OHL teams and stuff like that?
Not even – if I tell you that any – I can't even explain the extremeness of how many looks I did not get from anybody until my last year. And it was kind of a blessing because I was with CompuWare, which is Carmanos' team, who at the time just built CompuWare Arena, which was where the Junior Whalers played. So – luckily, being on a team like that, going to national championships, you know, we had Dave Leguan was there just before that. He had just left to go to the O. So, you know, there were some spots open, but that was the only year. And, you know, my dumbass wanted to go to college. I thought I was going to go to Michigan State. And, you know, I used to go to these hockey camps in Traverse City, Michigan. I'm like, yeah, I'm going to go to Maine. I'll be like Paul Kariya. I'd just probably just be a sniper. That'd be the best thing, you know. Little did I know. I had no fucking clue. I'm like, well, I think I did 3 homework assignments this year. I don't know if I think it was like a 5-game suspension for a fight in college. And I believe it was like 2 fights, it was a 10-game, 3 or 4 fights, it was a season. I'm like, my OHL camp, I was told, if I don't fight at least 3 times per scrimmage, Jesus, then you just don't, you know. And luckily, I messed out on – I was in an era where I had just missed some big dogs. Mm-hmm. And you know, so I lucked out with age wise, because right before me, I think every age in my opinion, some bad, it's bad motherfuckers were 70s. I mean, those guys were a different era, 80s guys. Yeah. I mean, as opposed to now, it's a whole different world.
Well, even playing with the Spitfires, you had some guys that Mike Hansen, he had 216 penalty minutes. You had Andy Burnham? Yeah, 165 penalty minutes. Joel Swell, 143.
Joey Sewell, the Indian from the Sioux. Yeah. The guy's from the reservation. Are you fucking kidding me?
What was he like?
When I got traded to the Sioux, because he had been on my team, and when I got traded, man, it was a crusher, because if you can imagine playing in the OHL, and I got drafted, so.
So what kind of hockey player were you then?
I wanted to be a left winger, Joel Nieuwendyk, you know, Eric Lindros type, but I honestly couldn't body check for the life of me. That's an art that I just never picked up. I was, you know, really good hands when I played. I mean, I would score points, but it was only so much, you know, as I was coming up was when it was starting to be like, you had to get points. You couldn't just go out there and fight. There was a few guys like that, but, you know, pretty much up and down winger, wanted to be, you know, goal scorer. You know, 20 goals a year, 20 assists a year, never nothing good in growing up. And In the OHL, I honestly, my first two seasons, I got 2 points, and it was in one game. So
you had one goal, one assist.
In one game against London. I remember suiting up and going to school. I'd have these schedule books. You're supposed to put your assignments in it. Every day, my teacher would look, and she's like, who the fuck? That's not your assignment? She wouldn't say fuck, but what's John Erskine? I'm like, oh, they want me to go home two times is today. They're like, well, that's for your assignments. I'm like, no, today's John Erskine.
Hopefully it's not my assignment.
Yeah, I'm like, fuck, what do you mean my assignment? Kippy Brennan got traded. I got to keep my buck, you know, keep my head on. Mm-hmm. So he was, you know, John was one of the names in the league at the time that was, rung bells across the league.
When was your first hockey fight? Like your first one ever? Like gloves off, like let's go.
Gloves off was in the OHL. My first fight was my first game against Nick Jones, Sault Ste. Marie. We still bullshit. It's great because, like, guys, we all still bullshit on Facebook. We still talk. Yeah. Especially the Spitfires, but even the other tough guys, like, you know, even if it's one or two lines here and there, all the guys. I mean, Steve Ott played for the Spits after me. Craig Mahan Rideout, obviously, who's coaching in the OHL, doing really good.
Yeah.
Boy, great. I love him and his brother Matt, both good kids. And so it's great to keep in touch. But yeah, it was my first fight. It's actually on YouTube. Mauled them, talked for like 10 minutes before the announcers brought it up, and you could tell it was my first fight too. It was just holding them out for dear life. And after that one, the crowd went crazy. And you know, in Windsor, there's no pro football, there's no pro baseball, so the Spits, you know, have some weight with their name. So after that, I think my head went from a pea to like a watermelon. I thought it was over after that. I was like, I retired from school. I had two of my buddies that were just going to clean my suits for me. I thought it was over after one fight, but. Little, you know, he was a tough guy though. Nick Jones fought everybody every year, you know, tons of PIMS.
Mm-hmm. Bob, go ahead, brother.
So what was your draft like? Like, how did your draft go? Like, when they came to see you, or did you get a letter, or how did that go?
I talked to a few, Leamington, Junior B, Tecumseh, and I really thought, like, I honestly thought at the time I wanted to fuck it. No idea what I was thinking, try to play college hockey. But ended up at the end realizing what the OHL was and wanted to go there. So Toronto Maple Leaf Gardens, right before they tore it down, is where the draft was. Literally had, I believe they had the construction getting ready to tear the gardens down. So I got to see that going there. My dad drive all the way up there. Joe Thornton, I just got drafted, I think first pick overall. Waiting it or the year before, so he was there shaking everyone's hand, waiting in the draft. You know, I think LeCavier went first and to pro that year, but for the OHL draft, you're talking about,
yeah,
the OHL draft, yeah, that's the one. I was at Toronto Maple Leaf Gardens, went there, stayed the whole time, probably about an hour and a half in, 2 hours in, started looking really bleak. Only talked to I think Plymouth. Because it was a hometown team. We played at the same arena. Mm-hmm. And I don't even think I talked to Windsor. It was like Belleville or someone else. Ended up leaving with my dad without getting drafted. So halfway down, coming home, didn't even talk to the team at all. It was the 16th round when I left. And I got drafted the end of the 17th round, if you could believe that. No one even believes it. When I tell people, they're like, what kind of fucking sport has 17 rounds of drafts? I'm like... They give everyone a chance, you know what I'm saying? It's as long as you can bust your ass, you're going to make it a chance to make it.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Man, I was at a game. Well, you were obviously there, but I just seeing you for the first time skate out on the ice, I'm like, who the fuck is that guy? Because you were a head taller than everybody else.
Yeah, there was only a few guys that were that tall. Like, we had Kit Brennan on our team. Absolute killer. And that's one of the guys who, I mean – Put the fear. That team we had 1 year, I think we had five guys drafted. We had four, one or two first rounders. We were, I think, projected to be a close finish in the Memorial Cup. So literally two to three games, maybe a few weeks in the season, five guys missed curfew, and he traded half the team.
Oh.
And that was the first time I'm like, I may see a shift or two. It didn't work out good. Everybody got traded. Matt Cook got traded. Kit Brennan got traded. Everybody that missed curfew, which was all the big guys on our train with, you know, team with a draft pick behind them, traded. So great. I think I got a few shifts and actually started playing, getting a little confidence. And that's that was probably like, you know, a few weeks into my OHL career. That's how it started.
Yeah, I just, like I said, I just seen you skate out the first time and I was just like, oh my God.
Like, well, coming from the States too, and then when you hear him start yelling your name, honestly, I would play two shifts a game. So if you were there, you saw it, I'd play two shifts a game and I would wait for the other fucking guy to, like, son of a bitch, here he comes. Yeah. And he, you know, come from the States, we never did buckets off. We never circle around, took our elbow pads off. So sure enough, fucking other guy goes off. As soon as it happens, I would, every single time, a tap from the coach. So the two tough guys would be my two shifts of the game. And, you know, it's a little bit frustrating, but if it's that, or, you know, obviously there's no way I would. I mean, I think I fought three times at training camp. I fought a Windsor guy twice, Terry Banjanovic. I remember his name. They called him Banner. He's a pretty tough guy, a little bit older, but fought him twice. I think I fought Ryan Shaver, who was on our team.
Yeah.
But that was just in tryouts. That was like an open skate. Like the first day, I'm like, Jesus, I have to do this every day to stay on the team. Fucking rough gig.
That's got to be really disheartening that, you know, your shift is when you get the tap, you know.
It is, and it's, I mean, it's not that I love fighting, and I really, really have a rough time seeing some of the shit that goes on nowadays in hockey. But yeah, I mean, how many guys have you heard that, you know, whether it's, you know, depression, shit that goes on with that, just knowing that you have to do that. If you have a shift, it's a different story. But if you're just going out to do that, like the old school guys, yeah, that's a different breed right there. Like, you know, Boogeyman, those guys, that's definitely a different breed.
I was just about to ask you, who is that one guy that you, like, knew you were going to have to fight to where it was like, I'm not sure how this is going to go?
I got there, DJ Smith just left. As soon as we got in the OHL, a few of the guys, all the main big guys that were around, I really, really lucked out, and I hate it because it's tough for me to rate myself because I never had the huge fights. Mm-hmm. I'm thinking of my toughest. I never got to go, you know, any of the super Erskine one time, and it was kind of, you know, a bullshit, like, fumble. He kind of over the net and didn't really fight. Mm-hmm. Just because I didn't really play a regular shift, you know? So it was tough to get the fights because those guys were playing a real shift. Erskine probably didn't want to go, you know, as a first-round pick. He ain't going to go off the bench for, you know, for me. So he's a smart player, understood. But, yeah, definitely frustrating, and especially after 6 months of that, traveling to Sudbury, sitting in the front of the bus, picking up, you know, 2 liters of dip bottles, you know, fucking the veterans are throwing at you, hey, Kugel, you turn around, like, well, where's the bus pointing? Forward, they're like, well, why the fuck are you looking this way? Oh. All right, guys, sorry about that. Just, you know, bullshit hazing for the whole year, cleaning up the bus and shit, and then you get to go out and hopefully, you know, win a fight. But it is what it is. I enjoyed it.
I would just say to him, hey, you better watch who you're fucking talking to, because when that guy rocks you, I'm just going to stand there and laugh.
Oh, exactly. We had Pete Sarno. He was like a leading goal scorer. He was always really nice. But I mean, like I said, there was Kip Brennan was a top pound for pound guy. Even when he went to LA, he was fucking a really, really pound for, you know, a tough dude. He was a crazy motherfucker too, that guy, Kip. I don't know if you ever remember him playing.
Yeah.
He was, funny story about him is, like, probably like 7-8 years ago, there's a fucking reality show with Dr. Drew. It's like Celebrity Rehab.
Yeah.
And some model, Amber Smith, is on there. She was the guest model, and I'm sitting there watching it, and it's fucking hilarious. I'm there with 10 of my buddies, and she's like, I snuck out, I snapped. I went to this party, and it's in L.A., and I remember he got drafted to L.A. She fucking goes upstairs. She's all, you know, obviously got back on the bottle, and next morning, she's all embarrassed, comes out, fucking sitting there, and it shows, I'm like, it's fucking Kip. Fucking Kip. Kip fucking got her. He must have been playing for the Kings. He had, like, a fisherman hat on. He was fucking... I fucking found him too. I fucking kept rewinding. I'm like, that is him, that motherfucker. I had the fucking grin on him, that Irish grin. I knew it. Oh, he's still doing good, obviously.
That's fucking funny, man. Hilarious.
What was the one thing you enjoyed most about playing in the OHL?
My buddies, like, right, like, you know, those guys I still talk to. It's I used to go up to Toronto to see, like, a few of my buddies, Goldenberg and a few of those guys, and it's just, you know, it's a good experience to do stuff like that. I went to a Windsor game probably like 3 years ago, me and Mark ride out, and plan to go over a little more if they would have started up. I don't know what's going to happen this year, but probably won't be till next year.
I think I seen they were doing a 25
gamer, and plus the playoffs, they were going to use like three or four cities, I think.
Yeah, that's it. I mean, it's rough. Hopefully next season some of the restrictions will lax up. But as I said, when I was working for Xfinity at the end there, to show the difference in size in guys, when I was coming up, I mean, and like I said, I'm an 80s baby, so I'm still not even the real bad era. Like before me was Brandon Sudgen, Trevor Gillies. Like I had just missed those guys. And those guys both, I'd went to camp with before I got drafted, like a little rook, you know, camp for draftees from your agent. And both those guys were there. Awesome guys, took time. I mean, totally would spend 20 minutes after practice working on me. But I mean, Trevor Gillies, if you just look at his picture alone with the Fu Manchu, I mean, he was out there to intimidate the big, I mean, he was such a, he's, his dad did it. He, you know, he comes from a line of enforcers and he very, very good at his job. Mm-hmm. So that's what I was talking about. Mike Scroy, the second year I was there, we got different coach, Tony Curtelli. This was before the suspension. So he came from Springfield, the junior tier two team. And he brought this guy in that kept saying, "Yeah, the Reaper's coming for you. This fucking Reaper, man. It's fucking right. He can do it. Fucking Mike Scroy." And that was honestly, because like I said, I never had a back and forth till that. I was never cut open. I was never poor. I was never bleeding. It came to a point where I grew up, I had braces, and I was almost trying to show my mouth because a few of the guys on the team would pull the retainer out with the teeth. And I'm like, that's the fucking coolest thing I've ever seen in my life. And I'm like, what do you mean? What are you talking about? I'd be fighting. I'd be like, come on, switch up to left. Switch lefty. Fucking put my jibs out there trying to get some fucking, like, just want to, like, two or three gone to pull a retainer out. And I never was cut. Jeff Paul one time, I thought he was a righty, and he turned left on me. And I remember them shaking a little bit, but I was never, like, you know, you see, like, John Miristy, some of those guys, yeah, the back-and-forth battles they have. But Mike Scroy was a, I mean, and that wasn't, he wasn't at his prime either. After that, he left, and then he went to fight, I mean, Boogeyman, ever, McIntyre, literally, and he's the greatest guy. He's training kids now in Florida, really doing good, giving back. He's a good MMA fighter too.
Yeah, we actually had a guest on the show who fought that McIntyre. Gomesy fought him. Tommy Gomes fought him.
Who did?
Tom Gomes.
He fought McIntyre?
Yeah, he fought McIntyre, yeah, and did, like, good.
From what I hear, and like I said, it's because Mike fought everybody, so he knows firsthand, and it's two or three times, fought Miristy, Bugard, every McIntyre. He said that he's one of the, I believe, Big Mac's probably, I think he said, hardest puncher, top two. Yeah. They said it's just, it's a different level. He even said that, honestly, he said that he believes that, or even, you know, I don't know if he said they would beat Probert, but it's just a different size, you know. They're so big and strong with reach. It's just like athletes are, you know, changing altogether.
I noticed too that you played with Mike Rupp.
Yeah, Rupp's a good guy, American kid.
I was really going to say, what was he like when he was here in Windsor?
It was a little adjustment for both of us because he came from a high school hockey in Ohio. So if you can imagine, that's a little bit adjustment coming to, you know, playing the Spits, but. He's a first rounder, so he got his time. He's always a really good player, really good guy. You know, it's kind of quiet, didn't talk much, but obviously that's probably what it takes to go far, mm-hmm. you know, and that he did. Played mm-hmm. for the Rangers, had a good career.
Yeah, he did. He played New Jersey, too. I think he won the cup there once or twice, yeah, I want to say.
He has he's actually on the ice. And one of my favorite NHL things, it's the 5-on-5 brawl between the Rangers and New Jersey.
Yeah.
They talk, yeah, before the puck drops, they talk, both teams stop and brawl. Cam Jansen's on there too, ex-Spitfire.
That was right off the face-off.
Right off the face-off. It's beautiful. Everyone circled up. Everyone drops the gloves. I think the center guy dropped the helmet. I forgot who it was.
New Jersey, it would have been, I forget who it was, but he was cut bad, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
Rupper was in there. I think Bolton was in it.
I'm trying to think who the fuck that was.
Rupper did fight Bolton in that.
Yes, he did.
I wanted to do that. Yeah, Rupper fought Bolton there. He could fight too. I mean, he's my size. He's 6'6", but.
Oh, the guy who left the ice bleeding was Ryan Carter, was who left the ice bleeding.
Yeah.
That was a bad cut too, real bad. Rob, before we go into what all like freaking happened there, do you have anything else before we lead into the big brawl there?
Nope.
Okay, so it was October 25th, 1998. You were playing a game against Owen Sound. Rideout rocks Sean Avery. Crushes him. Big brawl happens, okay? Everybody starts fighting on the ice. So what I want to know is, like, through your eyes, and you're on the bench and everything, what did you see through your eyes? Is there something that you didn't like that was going on out there that caused you to jump the bench? Or was it just like, fuck it, I'm done, I'm going? Like, what all happened?
If you look at it, it's Avery that comes over with a two-hand over the Rideout's shoulder. He comes over there. He jumps the bench, comes over with a two-hand, which, I mean, at that point, I'm still upset. But I wasn't going to jump the bench at all still. It would have to be some crazy things, and you would almost have to, which is what it leads up to, is that you'd almost have to get help from your coach to jump the bench in a situation like that, which, you know, obviously I did. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I didn't tell that to David Branch when I went there, just because that's, you know, that was the right thing to do. I didn't want to say it was him, but he asked me several times if Tony had sent me out there, my coach at the time. I'm like, no, of course not. But it was just an extra man on the ice. It wasn't, I didn't see much, except at the time it was 6-on-5. So even if it was a guy that was, you know, had 2 penalty minutes and it was a 6-on-5, someone was going to have to go out there, you know. Now, was someone going to have to go out there and sucker punch or rushing from the side and do a Steve Austin? No, but someone had to go out there to at least make it even. I probably took it a little extreme.
Yeah. You know how many times I've had a coach pin me on a bench? Like, you know what I mean? Like, trying, like, you're not the only one that's been, you know, in that situation. And the funniest thing too, is if Sean Avery's swinging a stick like that, I have a note here. Avery got 8 games out of it.
Yeah. Well, the next day, so after that happened, my coach called me at the time. Me, the owner, Steve Riolo, went up to see David Branch in Toronto. So we go up there, we drive up there in the morning, and I'm still thinking nothing of it. It's a fucking fight. The year before, Jesse Bullerice for Plymouth had two-handed Bootlin, I believe, in the face. Baseball swing his face. I want to say there was some type of – I know he crushed in his face, maybe orbital. Serious injuries. Two-handed, behind the net, turnaround, two-handed swing, in the face. And he was back playing. So I'm like, obviously, it's not going to be. I don't know why they're doing this. So we go up to Toronto. I go on the meeting with them. And again, just lack of discipline by me probably and a big fucking head. But he asked me what my job was. And I'm like, it's to strike fear in opponents. I'm like, we had 6 guys out there. And Avery, obviously, he made it to the NHL for a reason, being an agitator. The guy, I don't know if he was drafted high, but I know that he wasn't drafted enough for the millions of dollar contract he got. Mm-hmm. But with Matt Cook, if you can agitate, those are literally the two worst, you know, shit talkers getting under your skin that I've been around. And Avery was even worse, I think. So yeah, once I told him that and was kind of talking like a, you know, kind of like an asshole, the Branch, he completely looked in my face, shook my hand. I hugged the guy. I thought he was like a fucking uncle. Hey, yeah. Dave, I'll see you later. It's fucking great. Go home, cramped in this little fucking, like a Mazda Miata. I don't even know. My coach had like a fucking two-door. I'm sitting in the back like a fucking, you know, cargo coming from China. And we get home, everything's good. So I show up at the arena the next day and I'm thinking, this is fucking awesome. And there's a restaurant right across from the old barn, not the new place, but the old barn. And we go get ham and cheeses there. Yeah. Great guy. So I'm in there and the coach calls me, goes, hey, come in the back door. So I look outside and I'm like, Jesus, ESPN. And I'm like, what the fuck? Hey, what's going on? We were supposed to get Fedorov at the time. So I'm like, he must have came in there. That's sweet. He's like, just come around the back way. So I go around the back door and he brings me in there, sits me down. I'm like, what's going on? He's like, they want to give you a lifetime ban. I'm like, what do you mean? For what? What are you, life? He goes, yeah. I go, the rest of the year? And he goes, no. He goes, they want you done for life. So I obviously my jaw's dropped. I'm like, what are you talking about? I'm like, can I play or no? He's like, it's not going to be, it's going to be a long time before you can play. Like, it's going to be litigation. You're going to go through some shit and we're going to have your back, but it is what it is. So from that point on, instantly the trucks were there, all the news shit, and started doing that circuit and talking to everyone and get lawyers. And then from there, it was a year long battle that, culminated with a meeting with every owner of the OHL at some place in Toronto. And my lawyer, Lawrence Greenspun, still remember, I've never talked to him in my life except at the fucking place. He talked to me a few times before, did it for free. and was awesome, helped me out with everything, was a great lawyer. And I went in front of him, I literally had to shed a tear. I mean, my career at the time was over. Yeah. And these guys were over here, every owner. And then they took a vote. And after that, I had to go through some type of anger management bullshit and fucking community therapy or something. I worked at like the fucking ice rink at the Zamboni driver, getting high off the fumes. Just fucking, not, you know, nothing. Just fucking around. But you had to go through it. Had to get letters signed. I remember I go into the anger management guy. He's like, well, why are you so angry? I'm like, I'm not angry at all. I'm like, I was laughing the whole time. Right after the thing, we were laughing, you know? Yeah. I guess he gave me a good report. So at the next year, I was allowed back in. And, you know, that's when I got invited to New York Rangers camp. And the head grew even bigger. Wasn't good.
do you feel that the Spitfires let you down, like, by not backing you? And you know, like, even the coach saying, you know, I'm the one that fucking sent him, like...
Yeah, I think, well, you know, and the only thing that would make me feel a little better, and it does make me feel better because he was a pretty good guy, is that he got let go shortly after too. So they cleaned house. I think it was almost like a much smaller situation, but with any pro athlete, like a Mike Vick, some bullshit, they're just like, we don't want to fucking deal with it. Everyone's going to be, we don't want to deal with it. If I was scoring 40 goals and getting 40 assists, it would be a different story, but. You know, I was playing 2-3 shifts, just a fan favorite. You know, I thought I could have developed a little more, which is what I wanted to do, but I don't think they let me down, no. I think it was a good business decision, and it's, you know, they got me a place to play. They didn't have to do that. They went out and went on a limb, made sure I had somewhere in the division that I wanted to stay a little farther than I wanted, but the suit was nice.
Now, when you came off the bench and you threw that punch, did you actually land it?
Yeah, I landed it. I mean,
good.
No, I didn't feel. I've never even landed any. Two or three punches I've had where I've had surgery in my hand, I've only felt. But I mean, it was the side of the helmet. His helmet wasn't off.
Mm-hmm.
And in that situation, and he was up fine. I heard he may have had some vision issues. Never have I confirmed it or heard more about it. Mm-hmm. But I feel even worse for the kid I chased. Honestly, because he was getting death threats. I want to say he almost quit hockey is what I heard, but he was a high draft pick too. Yeah. So yeah, after that, I mean, what are you going to do? You know what I'm saying? Yeah, you're never going to be able to roast anyone in the locker room. Yeah. You can't say any words ever. You just got to be a mute for the rest of your career if you're going to play. Mm-hmm. But he shouldn't have ran. I wasn't even going after him. I was just clearing the ice. You know, I was just skating around, clearing the ice. Sinisak was still fighting and he just saw me. And I guess he, you know, jumped to conclusions literally and took off.
Yeah. Oh, that was insane, man. Like he wanted no part. Like you could tell of it. He was straight up scared. Like,
but... hard, yeah. There's actually like a meme. It's like when you're something about a goon, when a goon hasn't had a fight in a little bit and it's me fucking chasing the guy around. It's great.
You're in fucking memes now for fuck's sake.
Yeah. It doesn't much.
I just feel that you didn't get a good, like I think you got kind of messed around on that just because I feel that you were judged on the whole situation based on how large of a guy you are, not based on like there was no fucking injuries.
No,
you didn't hear anything else about anybody else leaving the bench.
Yeah, I left everything on the bench. I was made an example of. I was, you know, this is the way I looked at it. I was 6'6", an American kid that told the commissioner I'm there to strike fear in people. And you have people with kids that are talented as hell that are thinking, where do I want them to go? College or the OHL? Should we send them to OHL? I don't know what's going on in the OHL. Well, there's a fucking runaway fucking 6'6" guy doing the Steve Austin fucking guns after he just fucking blinded some guy. Mm-hmm. Or we can send them to college where he can get an education, wear a full shield and fucking, you know.
Yeah, fair enough, yeah.
So it is what it is. It's a different – I was made for the OHL. I wouldn't have survived 2 weeks of college. I was made for the OHL.
Mm-hmm.
Or WA.
Now, you guys, I was just going to say, you guys went in, you did all the freaking appeal and all that shit too, right?
Yep. Yeah, appeal. Worked out too, like I said, but they waited till the next year. So I sat out a year pretty much, which was my draft year, which isn't probably not the year you want to sit out.
No.
Even if I would have got 15 points. I mean, and the funny thing is, I told you about those 2 points in one game. Well, that was at the end of my first season. So I was on a fucking goal streak. Coming into the next season, that was the last game of the year against London.
Fuck.
And yeah, I don't know the record for at, when you shoot the puck, how many skates it hits before it goes in. But I remember there was a two. The goal was a two-on-one. I mean, Jason Player coming off the wing shot it. Every guy in the fucking building fell. And I mean, there's no way it hit my stick as hard as it could. I just stood there and fucking bounced in. Then the assist, I remember I took a slap shot and it was like a ping pong game. It was 17 people. I broke two blades and then end up fucking coming out to the side and that guy went in. I acted like I fucking planned it. I was like shooting my gun here and shit. Riding the stick down there. But like I said, it's, hey, people, man, the fans in Windsor loved it. At the old barn, I don't, obviously you were there, but what an atmosphere. What a great atmosphere.
Well, the fans were basically right on top of you, you know, like it's an awesome arena to go to. I loved going there, the old barn.
Me too.
I was going to fight in Windsor. I was going to come back and fight. I actually came to do weigh-ins. I forgot what gym it was. I couldn't end up getting the license. It was too close to the time to get the license, but I thought I was fighting at the barn. They're like, yeah, the Windsor Arena. So I'm all excited. I'm going to fight at the fucking barn. I'm like, this is an old place. And sure enough, they had just built the Windsor Credit Financial Center.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh, man, it's a half-hour drive into the city, through the country. I'm like,
well, that would have made you even madder. So,
yeah, I'm like, I like the barn's right out of the tunnel. It's perfect. Yeah.
Now, you were supposed to fight Blake Nash, right?
Yep.
I went to high school with Blake.
Did you really?
Yeah, great guy.
Yeah, he's had a few fights. I went there. We didn't there do like a media day. It's actually on YouTube as well. I'm in there talking shit about fighting. And I went in first. I forgot. I think it was maybe Albert Mady's gym, Windsor guy.
Yeah.
But I went there, did mine. Then I was coming out. Blake was coming in. Nice guy. Sat there, talked to him for a second. But yeah, unfortunately, it never panned out. And I was pretty upset because I didn't want people to fight if you don't show for a fight. Obviously, it's a, you know,
Yeah. Scrape
against your thing. So I wanted to make it real clear that it definitely was licensing issues, but I was really excited. I was excited to come back.
You fought fucking
Butter?
Yeah, you fought fucking Butterbee.
How Butter.
How did you land that fight?
My whole MMA career, literally, I had a buddy, Mike Klein, and his uncle was a promoter over here. It just became legal. Wild West, where literally they're pulling guys out of the crowd. Like a jean short cutoff, you slide the cup right in your boxers and just literally out of the crowd. If you could get up there, it was absolutely ridiculous. So the first fight, I remember them, he called me and said, you're fighting Friday. That was my first fight. And this is amateur. So I had two or three amateurs. And then this came up. This had just came pro. He's like, you want to fight Butterbean Friday? It was a Wednesday. And I swear, I'm like, what the fuck? I'm like, no, I don't want to fight. I've been smoking everything. I'm like, I wouldn't. He's like, they're not going to test you. Don't worry. It's just getting. I'm like, they're not going to test me. Let me think about it. I'm like, I'm going to throw a number because you weren't getting shit for fights. You're getting like maybe 500, 600. I'm like, Butterbean, give me, I should have said a bigger number, like an asshole. I'm like, give me 1,500. He's like, all right, done. He's like, I'll have a guy picking you up tomorrow. I'm like, whoa, 1,500. I'm like, I'm not going to lie to you. I've been smoking. He goes, don't stop smoking. If you stop doing anything, it's going to fuck up your sleep routine. It's going to fuck up everything. I go, so just keep doing it. Swear to God, I didn't have a car at the time. This is how bad I was doing. He had a guy pick me up, a little chubby Indian guy. He picked me up, and he took me to do my pupil dilation test to make sure I didn't have, like, brain damage for getting there.
Jesus.
I'm driving around with him. He has a bowl packed in the middle of the car. The promoter, he's going, hey, I got this for you. Hit this. I'm going, before the brain test? He's like, yeah, calm you down. I'm like, oh, I better fucking, hopefully I finish him quick. Because if Butterbean beats me in a fucking battle of attrition, I will leave the country. Cardio battle. But he was a really nice guy, and they kind of gave him a shit end of the stick. We're putting you against this guy. He has no idea how to wrestle. He just throws bombs, and first thing I did is take him down. I wrestled in high school. Yeah, my boy wrestled. Like, I've where I'm from has like a pretty big wrestling background. So I'm fairly, I played that plan the whole time.
Mm-hmm.
Nice. So after back to the hockey, after Branch gave you your assessment, it was originally 25 games, right?
I believe it was the full season right off the bat. I don't believe it was originally 25 games. I think that's what we wanted, but it was lifetime ban was the original. He didn't hand down unless he handed it down before my suspension was only handed down after I had that meeting with him. So, like I said, it was a shocker. I don't remember any 25 games.
Just something I found on the internet, like it said originally, Branch was handing down a 25 game suspension, later revised the lifetime ban, which ended up taking over the whole thing.
Yeah. Unless he was planning on doing that, and he may have said that because, I mean, he's honestly, even you talk about Mike Hansen, I still talk to him. I still keep in touch with him, who's also another absolutely great human being and one of the hardest heads and toughest guys around. He came from Sarnia. He was a real tough guy. But he, I forgot what I was going to say about him. Son of a bitch. Fucking stinks, bro.
He was a nice guy. Well, we were talking about Branch and the assessment, and then I think you were saying something about
Even till this day, people still OHL guys, Windsor guys, fuck David Branch. Like I don't think there's very few hockey guys that think he's done a lot for the OHL or appreciate what he's done as far as like taking. I mean, he wants it to be pretty much just European hockey. He doesn't want. He's been like that since the beginning. And you know, besides that, he's been in the position for how long? Because there's so many other guys that played hockey that were younger that could have been, I think, helped the OHL a little bit more. But
yeah. Well, he's more for the owners, like, you know, Gary Bett, right? Not much for the players. He's more for the owners.
Right. And you know what you're signing up for. The guys going to the OHL know exactly what they're signing up for. All the guys that are going back and forth, college or the OHL, you know exactly what you're getting. School is going to be a minimum per school for me. I never went to school in the OHL and stuff like that. It was, you know, hockey's your life. It's about hockey pretty much.
See, I think that the OHL should have same kind of thing as the NHL does with your, you know, they have the one guy that hands out the suspensions and all that stuff. You know what I mean? Like Brendan Shanahan was one of them at one time. And then who was the other one? The other tough guy, Peros?
Yeah, it's George.
I think.
Girls, yeah,
you know, I think the OHL should have something like that, not where it's a business decision, because a lot of times these guys were tough guys that end up getting that job, right? I think Brian Burke originally took the job first, and then he took a successor and he took Brendan Shanahan, you know, which he knew what kind of hockey player he was, he knew what kind of, you know, what tough guys were, he knew how important the enforcer was. And how important your goal scorers are, you know, to make the game a balance.
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, sales for a minute there. I mean, this was a while ago, but I remember it was like the rodeo and hockey. It was hurting for a minute. I mean, now it's getting back in the limelight, the NHL now. But even to be honest with you now, I like it and I watch it, especially the Rangers, because that, you know, that's who I went to training camp with. I watch the Wings and stuff too, but I mean, the third period, if there's a three goal, you know, if there's a three goal lead with a minute or two left, I used to be glued to the TV, you know, but now there's probably, you know, three or four heavyweights in the league. And like I said, when I was working for Comcast before I left, I was actually doing some places with the new Wings, and I'm not going to name their names, but I would show up and honestly, the girl there would be like, yeah, that's so-and-so, that's him. I mean, you gotta be shitting me. It honestly looks like a eighth grade Swedish guy. Yeah, like no sandals on, no facial hair. I'm like, I just don't, you know, it's just a whole different. Back then, the guys literally every guy had beautiful white teeth. When I was around, there was, you know, three teeth on the team. You know, it's a different too for marketing too. People that don't love hockey, just like with fighting, MMA, you know, boxing not so much, but MMA. If you don't hate violence and you don't even know MMA, you're still going to be attracted to it because it's a fight.
Yeah. Right. There's been a lot of fighting this year in the fucking NHL, but I think it's because now they're like you're playing 3-4 games sometimes against the same team and all in a row. So everybody's getting sick of each other, right?
I see that. There is some stuff there, but I mean, like, you know, there's a few guys in there I can name, but I can't even name the top heavyweight, like the scariest enforcer in the league. I have no idea who he would be. Or
I'd probably have to go. Ryan Reeves is probably who
I would say. I go with Chara.
Yeah.
Well, always. I remember coming up when they're like, yeah, there's a guy in the Western League that if you played him, you would have to fucking go him. He's a fucking giant. And it was him. It wasn't a huge fighter, but if he grabs you with the reach, you know, just like any tall guy with a reach, if he can hold you out there, it's going to be fucking, you know, dangerous. Like you were saying, yeah. The guys, Andy Burnham from Windsor, the day before a ride out, they both guys played for Plymouth. So we were playing Plymouth. And I remember I'm talking like, listen, you know, you're fighting right out in Burnham. Both guys, the only two fucking rookies I was supposed to fight. One, Burnham's about 6'5", rideouts, strong as shit. I mean, body like a He-Man, you know.
Yeah, he's big guy. Jacked.
Yeah, and just always ready to go. Always ready, you know, angry at the time, ready to drop his mittens. We warm up, and they're on the other side, literally, right before the game. I'm thinking, all right, I'm going to go ride out first. I'll do it off the draw. They both come in our locker room. They got traded in the warm-up. I'm like, another time, I'm like, this is fucking amazing. I'm lucking out. Yeah. Like every time we're going to a game, like, oh, it's like Oglethorpe, you know? Is Ogie there? Oh, he's not in the lineup. And every time they would be in the lineup last minute, he fucking broke his toe. I'm like, fucking beautiful. Fucking beautiful.
A fucking shopping cart deal.
The what?
The old fucking shopping cart deal where you wheel out of one room into the other.
Everything. And then you go places. Like, I never played on the road trips. Like, what was it? Peterborough. They had a guy named Bob Crummer. He's literally 5'9" and fought everybody. Lefty. Hurt people. And like, I never played against him. Ottawa, never played. But, you know, if I fight someone like that, I have so much to lose. He catches me. You know, it's going to look fucking. That's a highlight reel. If there was memes back then, that would have been a meme. If a 5'9" guy put me to sleep with the overhand looping left, you know, so there was a lot. Fighting little guys like that was always scary because you have so much to lose.
Well, plus those guys who are shorter have that low center of gravity.
We had Tim Sinisak from I forgot where it's from.
I actually literally just messaged him about coming on the pod too.
Amazing man. Tim said it looks like Lou Ferrigno, but about 5'8".
Yeah.
5'8" Lou Ferrigno. We used to call him Louis Drags Knuckles. Everyone, same thing. One of the harder pads, fought every fucking guy in the league, 6'8", fighting guys on our own team. Oh yeah, hey buddy, I'm from A-Bug. Yeah. I love Aberg. That's all I would ever say. Fucking Aberg. Yeah. He gave that guy $10 million. Said, "Pick your dream home. Build an Aberg. I don't care."
Yeah, 100% he would. 100% he would. Great guy though.
Oh, awesome! Yeah, he's in Tennessee now. I think. Talked to him once in a while too. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Awesome guy. So if you had to pick right now, Jeff, if you had to pick right now based on what you've seen, who's going to win the cup this year?
I like Pittsburgh a lot. I saw Pittsburgh play the other night, and with Sidney back, I mean, I know no matter what you think of them, I mean, it was almost like a video game. Mm-hmm. The way they passed the puck, and I mean, they looked really, really good. They were playing Washington too, so but they are moving I mean, goal after goal, overs hitting on all their bets. If you look at Pittsburgh, their overs hit a lot. Like, they score that many goals. I like Vegas too. My buddy's out in Vegas. My buddy Jamie, he's from Michigan, and he's out there. Loves the Wings, diehard, and now just completely brought his love for hockey to Vegas. I mean, he's been waiting. He's been out in the desert. Actually, it's in Pahrump. It's like 40 minutes from Vegas, waiting for the Golden Knights, and he's fucking gung ho big time.
Oh, yeah,
loves them. Yeah, but he only loves them when Fleury's in net.
Mm-hmm. Rob, you got to ask him our famous question. Hit him with it. Let's see how long it takes him to answer it.
Well, the only one that heard it, what, once in the OHL? I'm just messing with you, Jeff.
What did you say?
I said you only would have heard it once in the OHL. But it's if you had, you know, all the baseball players have walk-up music for when they come to bat. What would your goal-scoring song been?
I would probably do something funny, like fucking, you know, Lady Lumps by Fergie. something just like, what the fuck is that? Something like a fucking opera song. I don't know. If it was serious, it would probably be like, you know, some type of rap or maybe, you know, something to do with rock.
Bass, get the place jumping a bit.
When I fought Butterbean, it's funny because he only comes out to Sweet Home, Alabama, because he's from Jasper, Alabama. So the day before we're at weigh-ins, I show up to the fucking weigh-ins and he's there. I mean, looks like a guy selling corn on the side of the street. I guess he'd put all his money in roadside barbecue and it went bankrupt. So he's sitting there, he's talking to me. I weigh in. I have one buddy with me. He weighs in, the scale maxes out. I look at it, scale, boom, all the way maxes out. And I see him whispering. It goes to 400. And they're like, all right, they made up to like 418. I'm like, dude, shook hands, nicest guy. So the next day I show up, and it was such short notice. I told you it was a Wednesday. My one buddy who trained me hated the promoter. They had some feud. He couldn't go. He was banned. I showed up with like a bag. I look like a nomad in a fucking movie, knocking on the door. I swear to God, security goes, hey, come on, keep it moving, buddy. I'm like, no, I'm here to fight in the main event. He goes, get out of here. I'm really going to call the cops. I look like a fucking, a hobo. I just had a bag and a fucking pair of basketball shorts. I'm like, call him because I need to get in. I got to get dressed.
Yeah.
Over. Yeah. So I literally had no one. I met two guys there that were MMA guys, pretty big stars, at the time in Michigan, walked out with me and helped me out. But yeah, luckily it ended in like 41 seconds.
Yeah. I was going to say, you ended that shit quick.
Yeah. So it is.
So real quick before we're done here. So what do you do now?
Like I said, I was with Xfinity for a while as a sales manager over there. And I think it was probably in July, we got an email, just by email, everything let go. So we were supposed to come back in September, supposed to be October. So as of now, if something doesn't happen soon, I'm just going to go into another line of sales because that's really what I'm good at, talking and, a few solar things I want to get into. Right now, I've been doing a lot of trading, doing marketing shit, learning like that. I love it. And my boy plays basketball right now. He's really big into that. So I'm helping coach the team and doing extra training. He's going to a pretty prestigious Catholic school next year. So trying to get him ready for that and get in shape myself. Got a game of the weight over. I mean, like in the almost in the threes, like baby elephant.
are you playing any hockey at all or involved with any kind of hockey?
I haven't put skates on in 14 years.
Wow.
And just recently I have a few buddies because the lake froze, so they're like, come out and skate. And I'm like, thinking about it, and I got the old CCMs. Like, I don't know how old you guys are, but the old CCMs with the white heel lock. Yeah. I mean, if you pick up a skate now, and I have six size 16s, so literally I have to get the rivets fixed. I'm so fucking big, I bend it after like two seasons. The rivets actually will bend, it's so heavy. So I get them fixed. So I'm thinking, man, I just want to make sure the ice is fully frozen.
Yeah.
X-Goon goes through, and with those things on, there's no fucking way. They're 25 pounds each. Yeah, if I had my old Coho and the two fucking CCMs, that's like 240 pounds of fucking gear, and my Furlin gloves, I'm dead. I'll go right to the bottom, dude.
Those skates are old school. The ones with like the white stripe up the heel kind of thing. Is that the one you're talking about? Yeah.
Yeah, you probably don't even know them. They had like the white heel lock, and they were just packed. They had white blades. And now, I want to go do some stuff. I'm starting to do stuff, but sticks nowadays. I mean, absolutely. You're talking about like 300, 400 bucks a stick.
Oh, I'll never pay that much for a stick, man.
It's crazy. Yeah. I don't, they're 200 minimum.
That one slash and you're done with that stick.
Oh, yeah. My dad used to get a dozen woods, Sherwoods, shit like that. But I plan on getting back soon, especially this winter. I'll probably skate in the next 3 or 4 months. I have buddies playing all the time, beer league. Out of all the shit I ever did, pro hockey, pro box, pro MMA, I had hand surgery from hockey, fighting Kyle Defoe, and no surgery. I've had ACL replacement and lower back surgery from playing pickup basketball with like kids, bar league, bar league basketball and kids. So I've been pretty healthy with injuries. So even if I can get in a league with some guys, some bullshit league, I'll probably do that soon too. The last time I played, though, I swear to God, I played when I was – a quick story, though. I played this when I was suspended. Bob Duff, I don't know if you know him. I don't know I don't know if he's around or what he's doing, but he worked for the Windsor Star.
Yeah, Bob Duff.
And we became such good friends because he would talk to me after the games. He actually had a guy when I was not skating because I tried to go to Nova Scotia and play. I tried to go – there was three different times where I said, oh, I'm going to go to fucking Quebec. I'm like, I had my shit packed. Like, I guess I'm going to Quebec, guys. We'd have a going away party. As soon as I'm ready to go, they're like, the Quebec now respects the CHL's ruling. I tried to play on Junior B in the States, in some place in Lakeland, Michigan. Go to play the day before the game. I was so out of shape. When I tell you that I looked like fucking Happy Gilmore, it's an understatement. Happy Gilmore was like Fedorov compared to me. And the day before the game, they called me, same thing. They're going to hold up just because Branch said it everywhere. Western League, Nova Scotia, some island. Like, we're going to hold it up because David Branch, we got to respect him. It's kind of like, like you said, the owners are in this union of friends. It's almost like we're going to back everyone no matter what. So I couldn't play anywhere. So Bob Duff would have me come to Windsor. I forgot what arena was, and skate with a bunch of old dudes. Pick up hockey. Bullshit. I'm just bullshitting, just trying to get my hands, work around, get a sweat. It was like 8-9 in the morning. So I would get up at 7 and drive there. And some fucking little fat Italian guy every time, he fucking head down, gunning it as fast as he can. Right into my gut. I'm actually back and like, whoa, trying to back up. Hits me and falls. And he's following me around for about 20 minutes, fucking hacking me. He's an older guy. And Bob's like, and I forget his name, like Mario or Tony, like, Tony, don't fucking do it. And he's like, no, fuck him, Bob. I'm like, guy, I tried to hold you up. I was holding you. I almost fell with you. He's like, no, fuck that, Bob. And the whole time he's coming after me. And it was like an hour. I'm like, Bob, I'm trying, I don't want to. I'm on suspension. If the fucking paper sees this, Kugel on a fucking year off beats up fucking an old Italian guy. I fucking grabbed him. I remember his wife and kid were right over with low boards, and she's like, that's my dad. And I'm like, damn it, stop it, man. What's wrong with you? I had to like talk sense to him. I never talk sense to him. But yeah, so I don't even, if I play pickup, who knows? If there's a fucking another young guy out there that's like 6'4", I may, if there's a video camera out there, I may ask him to go buckets off.
I'll sign you up for my
beer. You couldn't do that now. There's so many cameras.
I'd love to come over the border and play.
What about golf? Do you golf?
My boy does. He's really good at it. I'm horrible at it. I actually, another funny story. Windsor asked me one time, because I was a fan favorite at the time, to play in a golf outing, a three-man golf outing. So I've only played literally golf probably 7-8 times in my life. So it was I forgot how it went, but Scrabble golf outing. So we go to a nice, this real, real nice fucking golf course in Windsor. Leguan's in it. Adam Graves is there. Everybody's there. So they're actually picking. I don't know if they pick or they pick out of a hat. It was three guys. Fourth guy was a celebrity, so-called. Like, the three guys that got me thought they had fucking got Tiger Woods. They thought, holy shit. They're like, Kugel, they're high-fiving. They're like, you must kill the ball. I'm like, you guys, you're not going to be happy to hear this. I had fucking Nike shoes because my uncle, who's in my exact size, golfs and has all the shit. So I came there with like a big Bertha. I look like I was on the tour. And these guys like, oh, fucking right, we're in. There's all these prizes. And sure, I'm like, guys, I hate to break this to you. I've never golfed a day in my life. You're like on a court, 18 holes. You're like, they're laughing. They're like, Cougs, stop fucking around. Go at her. And the first time I hit it, I remember I took out about 3.5 feet of grass. And they all look at each other and go, he never fucking golfed. They go, motherfucker, we got Kugel. I'm like, sorry, guys. And sure enough, that was the year when I came back, and Tom Webster, who came from New York, was our coach at the time. And so he had just been put, he was just there, new coach. We had already had issues. I came back from New York with even a bigger head. And he was like the cart behind me. So we're moving. And my boys, we had been drinking and, smoking cigars, smoking everything. And he was right behind us. And like I said, after that, it was shortly after where I ended up moving to the Sioux.
Fuck, man. Hey, but if everything, opens up, if we can finally get some like normalcy, Rob and I, with a lot of our guests, Rob and I want to play golf.
So, I'd love to. I'll get good. It's going to take probably 2 months, 3 months to everything open up. By that time, I could at least get a decent. I mean, you guys are probably pretty good, but.
No, I'm horrible, dude.
Oh, fucking great then.
We'll have a golfer.
No, so we'll have a blast. Drinking.
I just have a few beers and have a few cigars, shall we say, while I'm out on the course. And that's what I like doing, man.
I got gear. Yeah, I'm down to do that as soon as that, like I said, whenever it opens up, even skating once in a while, I'm down to do all that.
Maybe I can figure something out with Rob and we can do a little thing for the 73s tourney, and maybe we can, like, Rob makes a foursome and I make one with guests that we've had, and we'll do like head to head with our teams.
You got to get someone that you know is shitty though. I'm not going to be the shitty. I'm not going to be the guy out there. You got to get like a guy with one leg or something. So I'm not going to be that guy. I don't care. I won't do it.
Dude, I broke a fucking 100 once in my life. Once.
Oh, you say that. Yeah, fucking.
Ask Rob.
All right.
Fucking terrible, bro. Right.
I got gear, terrible. Man. As long as I look the part, I'm good. I got empty shoes and a big Bertha. That's all I know.
I only bring one club and a pair of shoes.
I carry it over my back. No, but I'd love to. I'd be totally down.
Yeah, we're down for sure. But it's a lot of fun. We got to say thank you so much, bro. This has been fucking fantastic, man. This has been great.
Fucking great. I appreciate you guys, and stay in touch, and hopefully we'll talk again.
Yeah, for sure.
We wish you all the best with what's going on with your life, and hopefully you do get called back for your job and everything, and
And your fucking son, good luck to him too, doing all the basketball stuff. Good luck.
Yeah. I appreciate that. He found as long as it's something, I care less if he's playing the flute or whatever it is. As long as he likes to do something, then he's not sitting at home, quote unquote, chilling or just not on his ass, something like that. That's all I care about. So great
gaming, video gaming.
Yeah, I mean, it's I don't know how they do those games. I can't get through one game. I can only go left or right, like old Mario Brothers. I guess there's no point in it. Yeah. I can't get a headache as soon as we start gaming, but.
I hear you, man. All right, Jeff, thanks, brother.
Yeah, you guys be safe, right?
All right, you too, bro.
Okay.
And there he is, folks. Mr. Jeff Kugel. That guy is a monstrosity of a guy.
What a beaut, though.
Yeah. I thought he was going to be like kind of like this arrogant kind of, but he wasn't at all, man.
Most of those big dudes, they don't need to be. They, everybody's already afraid of them.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, how intimidating would that be? 6'6" guy walking in, and then the size that he is, like, what did he say? He's a small elephant right now? Like,
he's like a beast. Yeah. He was a fucking great guy, man. I really enjoyed talking to him. He's going to actually come on here again at some point because we hardly scratched the surface with him. So I just want to give a big shout out to Jeff and just say thank you for, coming on the show. And he's got some hookups for us too that we're not going to name names, but he's got some like hookups. So fucking buckle up, people. Let's put it that way. So big shout out to Jeff on that one.
I just wanted to say one thing about that interview. Like, you got to figure this kid, he was 17 years old. And if you look it up on YouTube, you can see what happened. Yeah. And did he make a mistake in punching that kid in the head? Yeah, sure. Okay. But he was 17 years old as well. Mm-hmm. And, for the OHL to basically just fucking dirtball his career. He could have had potential going somewhere. He could have had potential doing somewhere. But remember, people, he was a guy that sat on the bench that got two shifts a game, and that was just to go out and protect the star players.
Mm-hmm.
And and then the league shits on him instead of getting him the help he needs.
Mm-hmm.
Or even if he does need the help, or is it the coach's fault for fucking giving him the taps on the shoulder to go out and beat the hell out of somebody?
Well, it's not even that, too. David Branser, he's like, we were hugging in the, meeting and shit, shooting the shit.
Yeah, his Uncle Davey said.
Yeah, he's like, then I get a ban. So, I don't know. It was crazy, man. But what a great interview. What a great guy.
Yeah. Well, that was just my opinion on it. I think the kid got, when he was a kid, he got hosed on that.
Yeah, fucking right he did. There's guys that have done way worse and got less. So,
He mentioned about that guy crushing that guy's face with the stick.
Yeah.
What did he get? 5-8 games?
Mm hmm.
And he gets 25 first and then a life ban.
Yeah, that's crazy,
man. I don't get it.
Neither do I. Ridiculous. That being said, we were just actually talking about Marc-Andre Fleury. So do you think that there's a shot that he finishes his career back with his old team there in Pittsburgh?
Well, anything's possible, right? I just think what they'll do again, because he's hot as hell right now. Yeah. And they're riding him. They're using him just like they did last year. And then come playoff time, you know, what was it? Leonard. Yeah. He's sitting there all fresh, ready to go come playoff time. And he steals the spotlight from him. You know, the guy works his ass off to get you into the playoffs, and then you shit on him. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. I'd like to see him in Toronto. Bye, Freddie.
Of course you would.
Bye, Freddie.
Of course you would. Also, James Neal. The Oilers waived him. Do you think he'll end up somewhere else?
That's a big maybe, you know. With his contract right now, what it's set. So they put him on waivers. Nobody picked him up. Mm-hmm. His contract right now, to pay him out for the rest of this year, is $5.75 million.
Wow.
And on top of that, next year, he's got another $5.75 million to go with that. Jeez. And he's not, you know what I mean? He's not playing very well. He doesn't have, what did they say? 8 games, like 2 goals, mm-hmm. 4 assists. I'm just speculating. Like, I looked at it, but I can't remember exactly. It wasn't in double digits or anywhere close to that.
Yeah,
but for five almost 6 million,
yeah,
and you don't even have 8 goals.
You think he'll end up somewhere else in the league?
I don't know.
Be like a
maybe come playoff time,
low risk, high reward type deal.
Yeah, I think he needs to be reborn again. You know, like Simmons there. You know, like, he turned his total freaking career around, I think, when he came into Toronto.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of Toronto, Toronto had a trade just recently.
Yeah, they got that Galchenyuk. Ottawa and the Hurricanes traded a few players. Galchenyuk went to Carolina.
It was Ottawa sent Cedric Paquette and Galchenyuk to Carolina for Dzingel. And then, so he's going back to Ottawa. He's already had a stint there before. So
Dzingel
goes there. Yeah. He's already had one there in Ottawa. He's already played there before. And then it turned out the Leafs then made a move and they picked up, what's his name again there, from
Galchenyuk.
Yes. They got him from Carolina,
right?
That's how it all went. It was a weird trade, but it was like he got traded there and then he didn't even go there, and it was like, come to Toronto. So it was kind of like that.
Well, he's been traded three times in 2 days.
Yeah,
or 2 times in 3 days, and he's also been traded 5 times in the last 4 years.
Well, yeah, he's bouncing around a little bit right now. While we're on the topic of the Leafs, what the fuck happened last night?
Okay, like, hold on. I got a couple more things about Galchenyuk.
Yeah.
He only makes $1.1 million. His very first year when he was, it must have been his rookie year, but he was playing in the minors, and then he came up and played for the Habs. He got 30 goals and 56 points at age 21. Wow. So there's potential there, and that's a pretty good pickup for the Leafs at 1.1. And if this guy can turn it around, you know, like,
low risk, high reward, baby.
Yeah, yeah.
So throw him on a line with Marner and Matthews. Tell me he's not going to fucking be buzzing when he goes out there.
Well, and the Leafs have had 18 different guys in their lineup so far. Mm-hmm. So they're really searching for that right. You know what I mean?
And they're also first place in the NHL, too, I believe.
Yeah, they didn't fucking look it in the third period last night, though.
That's what I was just going to say to you. Like, they had a complete fucking meltdown last night. So the Leafs are up 5-1 and then gave up 5 straight goals, lost in overtime. The part that I guess you could say that at least they got a point, you could say, kind of. But still, to blow a fucking 4-goal lead and to lose in overtime is tough. Tough.
Tavares gave up a huge pizza, huge pizza. But Freddie Anderson was trying to clear the puck, but he pulls it down at the blue line, drops it down, the puck ends up going, and they get a shot, puck ends up going in a corner. Tavares picks it up and saucers one out in front. Well, I want to say, I don't know if it was a defenseman or the forward pinches in and just goes and scores. And I'm just like, what? And,
right to him type deal.
Yeah, it was terrible. But maybe gets them a little bit off their high horse, a little bit of bite of reality. And, you know, now you got Ottawa again. I bet I'll put the house on it that they bury him on Wednesday.
Yeah, probably.
Because they play Wednesday, Thursday, Saturday against Montreal again.
Oh, do they? Damn. So real quick, Steven Stamkos had to go on the COVID protocol list, but they think that it's a false fucking positive. So why do they keep getting these false positives? It seems to be a thing as of late. But he is out, or he was or is out with a day-to-day injury as well, too. So we'll have to just keep an eye on it. But I haven't really checked.
Keep sending the test to Dr. Nick.
Yeah, like, I don't know what the hell's going on, man. So many fucking false positives.
Dr. Nick from The Simpsons?
Yeah. Hi, everybody.
Hi, everybody. I'm Dr. Nick.
You're fucked. You had something on Chicago.
Yeah, Chicago joined with Toronto and I want to say it was Edmonton for the PWHPA Women's Hockey League, helping them promote their league. Like, mm-hmm. Seems like a lot of these NHL teams are starting to back the girls, which is awesome to hear.
Oh, yeah. It's going to happen. It's just a matter of time.
Yep.
It's going to happen.
Like, that would be really cool if Windsor got a girls pro team. Like, how awesome would that be?
I'd hit up
a couple. I'd go see that for sure.
Sometimes their games are more exciting.
Yep.
Because they're back.
There was one hit. It was last week that was all over the internet of that open ice hit on that girl with her head down.
Oh, I didn't see it.
No hitting in girls hockey. Just like, you can. You can rub them out on the boards. You can body the stick. Like, you can check the stick, you know, like, you can do shit like that. But I guess from my understanding is there's no checking because women are more susceptible to concussions than men are.
How?
I don't know. Softer eggs. I don't know.
That's crazy.
Maybe they wouldn't
get them as bad because, like, I'm not being an asshole or anything, but the men are going to hit much harder, right? So you would think that the, like, ladies wouldn't get it as bad. Like, I'm sure they would get it, but it wouldn't be as bad, right?
Yeah.
Considering they're all kind of the same, like, size, right? Where the guys are fucking, you could have, like, a fucking Chara running at, like, Kessel, you know what I mean?
But there are some big girls out there too, and there's some smaller women out there that you know, just wheel around, and there's some bigger defensemen that, you know what I mean? Like, I imagine it's all the same when it comes right down to, you're not going to have every girl be this certain size, right? Mm-hmm.
Of course.
But I want to say it has something to do with their heads. Maybe the skulls are thinner. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. 'Cause we're a bunch of dummies, so we have to have the thick skulls.
Well, yeah, we're a bunch of fucking cavemen.
You had something on Brian Burke's first trade.
Yeah, Brian Burke's first trade was Nick Kiprios, which was kind of cool. Yeah, they had it. Like I said, I was watching that on TSN, and they had, I'm pretty sure they had Kiprios talking to Burke, and they were talking about the very first trade. Oh, I wanted to also bring up Lou Lamoriello got his 1,300th win.
Wow.
In the NHL.
That's crazy.
It is. And that's regular season, not playoffs. Just regular season.
That guy's been around forever.
And he's like the godfather of hockey. Everybody's afraid of him. Nobody wants to say anything bad about him. Like, I don't want to say anything bad about him on this show. Who knows? Landing a driveway with a helicopter.
Yeah. Waiting to just punch you out. Verbally bit slap you.
Gave my mustache and beard off me.
That'd be fucking funny. last thing you had Tony D'Angelo.
Yeah. So it turns out that his problem's been going on for quite a while. Like he went on one of the New York newspapers and was quoted as saying, you know, like, I blame myself for all of this. I am a hothead. I sometimes can't rein myself in, you know. But he when he was playing in OHL for the Sarnia Sting, he also had an incident there where he said some kind of slur to another teammate. And it was apparently he did. Like, it was never confirmed or denied, but it was alleged that he had said something, which gave him a lot of trouble there too. And it said that he had broken the code of conduct in the OHL as well. And now this is just carrying on into, and look at, you have what, 30, what is there, 32 teams in the NHL?
I think so, yeah.
31 or 32, let's say. And he went on waivers and nobody fucking wanted him. Nobody. And he was third in scoring and defenseman, third or fourth in scoring and defenseman last year.
Isn't he still fairly young too?
Yeah, he is. He is. I want to say he's like 24.
A guy like that, do you think a guy like that, a team like maybe the Red Wings could reel him in and like freaking goes up to like Yzerman's office and he could be like, hey, like, this is how it is here. This is what we do here. Like, do you think somebody could help him with his career rather than him just be a wasted talent?
I don't know. You're playing in one of the best cities in the NHL and you can't fucking rein it in yourself. Excuse me. Pardon me. That snuck up on me.
Like a burpee there from Rob.
Yeah. 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 Got me.
Drinking those GLs, crushing the blondes.
Yes. Just surprised me there. But yeah, there's no guys in the league anymore. Like your Mark Messier's or, you know, guys that can grab a hold of you, and just sit you down and say, what are you doing?
Yeah.
You know, you got all the talent in the world and nobody wants you.
Yeah. What's that tell you?
Yeah, there's something wrong with you. Maybe go get some help. Talk to somebody that's had these problems, like maybe Sean Avery or you know what I mean?
Yeah, but even towards the end, Avery kind of cleaned it up a little bit. He was still doing his thing on the ice, but he cleaned it up off the ice. He wasn't
– Right, but he didn't have as many problems with teammates as he did with other teams or the NHL.
Yeah,
this guy is having tons of problems with his teammates,
yeah, which – Not a good job.
No, you got to get it figured out if you want to stay there.
Yeah, because you're still young. You're a kid still. He's a kid.
Yeah, yeah. Like, where's your dad on this? Where's your dad on this?
I know.
I know.
Like, just kind of, I don't know. Hopefully he gets his shit together because he's a good player. So hopefully he figures all that out. On that note, there's probably like 5-6 hockey games on tonight. Do you have anything else you want to talk about, or are you good to go?
I'm good to go.
All right, brother, that is it. We're all done. Until next week, we got another killer interview coming next week. We're not going to say who, though. But, so you guys will enjoy that, trust me. So I'll give you guys a little hint. Amherstburg, we're coming your way next week, so we'll give you a hint like that, okay? So, until next week, Aunt Rob, we're signing off. We're out of here. See ya.
Peace.
Yeah, I can get behind anything.